Hey, brothers and sisters, this is Brother Patrick here in North Carolina. God bless you guys. I ask you guys to pray for me. I believe the Lord is leading me to stay in Seattle longer. I was just going to go to Portland for like 3 days, Seattle for 2 or 3 days, Vancouver for a couple of days, and get back down to Dallas because I'm trying to establish a household, establish a home for my family. But I feel the Lord is speaking to me. He wants me to stay in Seattle longer than I originally planned. So I ask you guys to pray about that. Those of you guys in Seattle, I really, you know, of course my total faith is in the Lord, but I got to hear from you guys. You know, I need your encouragement and your, you know, that you guys are going to meet with me and stuff. Last time I was up there, I met with like 10 different people, and at least more than that. But, you know, and some new people have contacted me in the Seattle area and the Portland area. Of course, it's not so far. It's only 3 hours, Vancouver, 2 or 3 hours away. We'll see all you guys. But anyway, what I want to talk to you guys about is just what I was thinking is being led by the Spirit. The theme that the Lord's had me on the last few days is being led by the Spirit. You know, a couple weeks ago, I had a whole theme about people being selfish and putting themselves first instead of, you know, strangers and the halt, the maimed, the weak, you know, and putting others ahead of themselves and their own family. Even as Jesus said, you know, even the pagans help their own family, you know, greet their own relatives. But, you know, you, God is perfect. Be perfect, therefore, because your Heavenly Father is perfect. Of course, we'll never be perfect. Jesus is setting that perfect standard, the golden standard there at the Sermon on the Mount, Matthew chapter 5, 6, and 7, where he tells us, you know, all of those things, it's the perfect gold standard of being like the Lord himself. Because the Bible says that God wants to conform us to the image of Christ. So our greatest purpose on earth is to bring glory to God. God's greatest purpose in us to bring glory to himself is to conform us to the image of Christ. So we should be like Jesus. And the gold standard of that is the Sermon on the Mount, Matthew chapter 5, 6, and 7. Though we shall never be perfect, and that's where the grace of God comes in, and the blood of Jesus to cleanse us of all unrighteousness, 1 John 1, 9. Anyway, brothers and sisters, the theme, you know, and I realize it now, before I didn't pay attention, but the Lord is just, you know, like I did on that theme, the Lord has given me this theme. I've been talking about being led by the Spirit. All the last 4, 5, 6, 7 videos I make is being about being led by the Spirit. This is another one. Brothers and sisters, in the Old Testament, before people were baptized in the Holy Spirit, which happened in Acts chapter 2, like Gideon, the story of Gideon comes to mind. He put out fleeces. You think about Gideon, and you know, that's what I was thinking about. You know, Gideon, the angel of the Lord appeared to him and called him, you know, Hail, mighty man of valor. And Gideon was like a wimp. He was the littlest guy of the smallest tribe of Benjamin in the, you know, he was in the smallest tribe and he was in the weakest area and he was the weakest guy and all that. He was kind of afraid of all of his neighbors who were doing all this idol worship. God told him to chop down the altar of Baal and, you know, make a fire out of it and all this and burn, you know, make an altar to God there in the town. And, you know, he snuck and did it at night because he was afraid. Then later on they had this battle to defeat the Philistines and all that. And God even used only 300 soldiers instead of using a lot. They had thousands, and then God reduced it all the way down to show that it was him doing it and not Israel and not Gideon. But the point of the story that I want to talk about is how that even after the angel of the Lord appeared to Gideon and all this, Gideon still put out a fleece, what people call a fleece. He took a, you know, the fur or whatever you want to call it, the wool of a lamb, and he said, okay, God, if you really spoke to me and you're really going to do this, what you told me, what the angel told me. Can you imagine an angel appearing to you and then you still don't believe it, you're not sure? There are people like that today. That's really what I started to make this video about, and I started redoing it because I was like, hey, this, I got to get this on here. There are a few people, I will say less than 10% of the people that I deal with in all the years I've been in the ministry, 14 years, who are what I would call spooky spiritual. You know, they can't even go to the bathroom unless they see a rainbow in the sky, a sign from God that, hey, I can go to the bathroom, okay? That's just, the extreme, wacky extreme. But the majority of people, brothers and sisters, are not erring on the side of they think God told them something or whatever, trying to be led by the Spirit. 90% of the people are, if an angel from the Lord appeared to them, they would still not be moved. You know, that's why they sing that old song, you know, I shall not be moved. Even God himself can't move them. And that's what religion, that's what, why revival tarries. There's a famous book, Why Revival Tarries. I haven't read the book. I would, one of these days, if I had time, I'd read the book. This is one reason why revival tarries, because people cannot be moved even by the Spirit of the Lord. As a matter of fact, every time revival breaks out, all the religious, old-time religious Pharisees are out there saying it's not from God, it's from the devil. Anyway, Anyway, brothers and sisters, they don't even know, they don't know the Holy Spirit from, you know, from a hole in their head. But so that's the majority of people, just like Gideon in this case, brothers and sisters. Gideon put out the wool of a lamb out, and he said, "Okay, God, if it's really you, let morning dew be on." He did it two different ways. He said, "For you know, one of those ways, he said, let the dew be on the on this fleece of a lamb, and not on anything else." So when he woke up in the morning, there was some water dew. The morning dew was on the fleece, but the ground was dry. So then he reversed it. He said, "Okay, God, let the ground be wet and the fleece be dry." You know, and then the next day, that's what happened. So, you know, Gideon did both ways, and all of these, you know, these tests to test God to see, confirm. Even after the angel appeared to him, even after he made an offering to the angel of the Lord, and then it was, you know, consumed in fire, the offering that he made, still did these tests. So, but the application I wanted to emphasize to you, brothers and sisters, on that is that in the New Testament, and if you go read Acts chapter 1, because Judas betrayed the Lord, the apostle Judas betrayed the Lord to the hand of sinners, and then Judas killed himself. So then the apostles said, let's cast lots. You know, they gambled, really like a gambling thing. They cast lots to see who would be the new apostle, who would be added to the 12. So they had two guys, you know, that they chose that had been with them, because Peter said the qualification to be one of the 12 apostles was to have walked with Jesus from the time of the baptism until his crucifixion. So, you know, there's the 12, and then there's other apostles like Peter, or Paul is an apostle, but he did not walk with Jesus. And so those apostles are not part of the 12. There's also Silas, and there's other times in the book of Acts when it talks about the apostles, and it's not talking about the 12. It's talking about Paul and his companions, and Barnabas, Silas, all those guys, and several other people. If you do a word study, or you can do a word search on the internet, or eSword, download eSword from eSword.com, you can do all these word searches. You'll see that there are other apostles, but not part of the 12, who had to have walked with Jesus until from the time of his baptism until his crucifixion. So anyway, they had this Matthias and this other guy. They cast lots. Okay, so the way the lot fell was the guy they chose. Okay, then if you continue to read the book of Acts, which is the only history book in the New Testament, you'll see that they didn't cast lots anymore after Acts chapter 2 when they received the baptism of the Holy Spirit. So I submit to you, brothers and sisters, that in the Old Testament, people didn't have the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit came upon individuals like Moses and the 70 elders, and then the two people that were overseeing building the tabernacle, and the craftsmen that built the tabernacle, and the you know, the Ark of the Covenant and all that. The Bible says God told Moses, you know, the Holy Spirit will come upon them to build it and all that. So, and then the Holy Spirit didn't indwell people like he did after Christ. The Holy Spirit couldn't indwell people because of sin. The Holy Spirit came upon people like Elijah. As an example, the Holy Spirit came on Elijah. He was able to outrun King Ahab and his chariots the day that the Lord allowed it to rain again after 3.5 years in Israel. After Elijah had spoken, there was no rain. Then he spoke again and there was rain. Elijah said the Spirit of the Lord came on him in zeal, and he was able to outrun you know, the chariots of King Ahab back to the city. But anyway, brothers and sisters, so in the New Testament, the Holy Spirit is not coming upon people in that same way. It indwells us. It is up, as they said, I heard a preacher say one time, it comes up upon you, up and on you. It's inside you like a river of living water, and it comes up and then on you. That's different than the Spirit coming on people, upon people in the Old Testament. It was not indwelling them. Only after your spirit has been cleansed by the blood of Jesus, which is only available since the resurrection of Christ, then you can become indwelt by the Holy Spirit. But the apostles, brothers and sisters, listen to me. I've made lots of videos on this. Maybe you've never seen my videos. Jesus blew the Holy Spirit. Receive ye the Holy Spirit. The apostles were sealed with the Holy Spirit. John chapter 20, Jesus said, receive ye the Holy Spirit. He blew on them. They were saved. They were sealed with the Holy Spirit. All Christians, just like in Samaria, in Acts chapter 8, it says they received the gospel from Philip the evangelist, and some people were healed, and they were filled with joy. They were saved. And then the apostles went down to see what was going on. Hey, the Samaritans got saved. Not only the Jews, that's before, you know, the Gentiles were not, first Gentiles were not till Acts chapter 10. Cornelius, and his household, the centurion. So Acts chapter 8, then the Samaritans got saved. They were mixed blood. They were half-breeds. They were, they were a mixed blood people there in Samaria. So the Israelites, Jesus had went there in John chapter 4 and did evangelize them also. So John and Peter went down to investigate. They had not been baptized in the Holy Spirit. They laid hands on them. They received the baptism of the Holy Spirit. And speaking with evidence of speaking in tongues and prophesying and all this stuff after they were saved. So Acts chapter 2, I'm going back to Acts chapter 2, when the apostles, the 120 in the upper room, the apostles and the others, even Mary was there, all those guys. Mary was not the mother of the church. Mary is not the mother of the church, but a member of the church. That's one thing you can remember to tell people who believe Mary is the mother of the church and all this. She's a member of the church. Mary was there in the upper room. She received the baptism of the Holy Spirit. And they were not drunk with wine, but they were filled with the Holy Spirit. And since that time, brothers and sisters, there's no more fleeces in the New Testament. There's no command or discussion about fleece. The Bible says that the Holy Spirit, those who are led by the Spirit, these are the sons of God. Romans 8, 14. So brothers and sisters, what I submit to you is we don't need fleeces. As a matter of fact, the law of Moses even tells us, the word of God tells us, that we should not have omens, trusting in omens and all these kind of things. Even though God gave us the stars and all that for signs, that's all true, brothers and sisters. And God does speak to us in different ways, various ways, through different means, through circumstances, situations, open doors and closed doors. The Lord does speak to us in all those ways, brothers and sisters. But what I want to tell you, the reason why so many people are duped by false prophets and duped on YouTube, as I've mentioned in a video the other day, A, they don't know the Word of God. That's number one. Another thing that people need to do is stop trying to read those prophets in the Old Testament and then thinking it's talking about you or talking about, trying to read into there. A lot of those things have already been fulfilled, even though they have multiple fulfillments. That's true. But it's called eisegesis instead of exegesis. That's eisegesis is seeing yourself in the Bible, reading the Bible and relating it to yourself. The Old Testament, prophecies. Oh, it's talking about me. That's where all the cults come from. Or exegesis. You read the Bible and let it speak to you instead of you speaking yourself into the Bible. Eisegesis, about I, but exo, it comes out to you. Anyway, brothers and sisters, most people I deal with, very few people, let me say this, very few people who watch my videos who I know as Christians, who are not pastors, very few people read the Bible at that theological level to try to be, some kind of a doctor of theology. Most people are reading the Bible to understand, how to have a better relationship with the Lord, to know the Lord better, how to evangelize, how to talk to your relatives, how to talk to your friends, how to, do the will of God in your life. That's what it's all about. So I submit to you, brothers and sisters, that until you became a master of the New Testament, you can read through the Old Testament, but like I said, caution. Don't try to start reading all into it and understand it, because you have to know the history of Israel. You have to know when it was fulfilled before and all that. You'd have to read stacks of commentaries, not on what other people's opinions, but actually what it meant and how it played out. Because, it was written for those people at that time, even though we can get something out of it. As the New Testament tells us, all that is for an example to us. It tells us that what happened to Israel is for an example to us, not to start building theology off of it. The Bible is fulfilled in Christ. All the word, the word of prophecy is Christ. The gift of prophecy is about Christ. It's all fulfilled in Christ. Now that's where all these sacred namers and people trying to keep the law and all that's where they're getting way off track. It's all fulfilled in Christ, brothers and sisters. So I submit to you and I suggest to you, number one, get in the New Testament and keep reading the New Testament and reading the New Testament and understand it. It's the fulfillment of the Old Testament. Everything you need to know about the Old Testament is in the New Testament. I will submit this to you also. It's good in the Old Testament, particularly if you read the history books, Genesis, Exodus, those things where it gives all the history. There's some history in Numbers and Deuteronomy, but it's mixed in there, and lots of it is just like a repeat. Deuteronomy, as a matter of fact, that's what it means. It's a repeating of the law. The book of, the First and Second Kings and all of that. That's history stuff, and it tells you the history of Israel. And so when you read the New Testament, you read what they're talking about, you say, oh, yeah, they're referring to what King David did. Read it, First and Second Samuel, all about King David, all the history of it. Take it as history, take it as like that, not digging in there and say, well, King David, before he slew Goliath, he picked up five rocks, so I need to go get five rocks and throw them at the devil, and then I'll be free. That's the kind of stuff that I hear. Brothers and sisters, after you are studying the Word of God and get yourself to be a master of the New Testament. And before, you know, and Revelation is last. There's lots of people that's never read the Bible. As a matter of fact, I've got a relative who's an agnostic, and he told me, well, it's no need to try to be saved because only 144,000 people are going to heaven. This guy's never read the Bible in his life. He opened it up, read one verse, about 144,000. Next thing you know, he's a theologian. You know, so there's no need to worry about getting saved because only 144,000 are going to heaven. Never read the Bible. It's always funny when people are high on drugs and start reading the book of Revelation. I mean, I guess that's where some of these cults came from. You know, Revelation is the last book you should be studying. Actually, brothers and sisters, got to start with the Gospels. Get that all down. Get the letters that the apostles wrote. Anyway, brothers and sisters, as my message is not just about the Word, the focus of my message is being led by the Spirit. So you have to have the Word in you so you'll not be deceived and tossed to and fro by every wind of doctrine. Get yourself rooted and grounded in the Word. Okay? But for all of my brothers and sisters who are more of a Baptist persuasion, you know, it's all Word and no Spirit. You know, it's like eating a bunch of bread. The Bible is our daily bread, our bread. Eating a lot of bread and then not drinking any water to wash it down. You got to have the Holy Spirit power to wash that bread down from head knowledge to in the Spirit. But just a minute ago, I was talking about those who had all Spirit and no bread. You know, you can't just live on water alone. You got to have bread. Every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God, you got to have that too, not water only. So the spooky spiritual people, they got all of this trying to be anointed and spirituality, and the next thing you know, it's New Age. It's Oprah Winfrey. It's spirituality. You know, Oprah has spirituality. I'm not a religious, but I'm spiritual. You know, that's some New Age mess. Next thing you know, you're talking to the Pleiadians and the aliens and all this kind of stuff, which is demons, fallen angels and demons. Anyway, brothers and sisters, you got to be led by the Spirit in line with the Word. That's what I'm trying to tell you. You got to have the Spirit and the Word together, brothers and sisters. Those who are led by the Spirit, these are the children of God. That's the point that the Lord wants me to stick on that and lead on with this message, is be led by the Spirit. So you don't need to put out a fleece. You don't need to worry about omens. You got the Spirit of God indwelled in you. If you have not been baptized in the Holy Spirit, I've got videos on that on my channel. You need to be baptized in the Holy Spirit. And the evidence of being baptized in the Holy Spirit, all through the book of Acts, we see people speaking in tongues and prophesying. See it about five different places in the book of Acts. Go read a great example to trump all the lies and religious Phariseeism of my denominational brothers and sisters. And sadly to say, many of these preachers are Holy Spirit blasphemers. Like Mike Hogarth, I like him, but it's an example of someone who's just always blaspheming about the gifts of the Spirit. Brothers and sisters, I will tell you this. To go read any challenge you hear from all these denominational people. For one thing, the Word of God stands on its own. Go read Acts chapter 19, verse 1 through 5. Go read 1 Corinthians chapter 2. I think it's also verse 1 through 5. Go read these things, brothers and sisters. You'll see what I'm talking about. But you have the Word to stand on, brothers and sisters. Anyway, God bless you. I want to cut this off. Tell you that it is by grace we are saved through faith, not of our own, but a gift of God. All things of God are received by faith. People want to be physically healed, it's by faith. You want to be saved, it's by faith. You want to be baptized in the Holy Spirit with speaking in tongues, it's by faith. I don't know how many people I've met, brothers and sisters. I will say 25% of the people I've met who have asked to be baptized in the Holy Spirit and did not receive it. Later on, I saw them talking junk about the Holy Spirit. Oh, there's no such thing as speaking in tongues on it because they hadn't received it yet. Lord knows the bitterness that's in people. I ask you, you know, I pray for all those people that I've encountered like that. You know, lots of times there's people who get bitter about not getting healed. They prayed to be healed. They didn't get healed. Then they get bitter about it, you know. And the Bible tells us, you know, not let a root of bitterness get in us. So, brothers and sisters, if you have any kind of a root of bitterness about not being baptized in the Holy Spirit, by not being used by God in any of the gifts of healing and not being healed yourself, I ask you to repent of that today. Ask the Lord to forgive you. Jesus said, you know, if we will not forgive others, He will not forgive us. Of course, you've got to forgive the Lord. Believe it or not, there are people that are angry at the Lord. That's the last one you want to get angry at. Like Job, his wife said, curse God and die. Job wasn't, besides Job being very smart and very wise, he definitely wasn't a fool. He didn't listen to that one. He told the woman, you must be mad. What are you talking about? He told his wife. Talking nonsense. That is nonsense, to be mad at God. I mean, by definition, that's crazy. You know, that's what I told my atheist relatives. Because they were talking about, you know, about what happened, you know, killing some of these tribes that were Nephilim. It's the reason why the children of Israel killed some of those tribes, even their women and children, because they were Nephilim. And they had this demonic blood in them, fallen angel blood in them. And my relatives, a couple of my relatives who are atheists, were saying, well, you know, God's mean and all that. And I said, well, let's just say for the sake of argument you were right and God was mean. Let's just take that as... let's just say that was true, which is not. Let's just say that it was. God was unjust. God's not just, even though that's not true. Let's just suppose it was true. By definition, if God is the creator and he wanted to be unjust, but he was offering you a pardon, are you telling me in your right mind that you're going to reject the Lord's pardon because you have judged the Lord by human standards and said he was unjust? Totally doesn't make sense. Who in the world, how arrogant and prideful can somebody be to think that they're going to judge the Lord because they don't want the Lord to judge them? They're mad that they don't want the Lord to judge them, and how God judged some people, and then they themselves are judging God. The depth of blindness, the depth of mental illness, when I say mental illness, I mean the mental illness of not believing in the Lord. Because the Bible says the fool has said in his heart there is no God. And to me, that is the ultimate mental illness, is to deny the creator of the universe, deny his creation and the creator. God bless you guys. I'm getting off track now. I better cut it off because I'm going off on a tangent. God bless you guys. You know, brothers and sisters, when I make my videos, I may seem like I'm, or whatever, you know, I'm not an angry person. When I make my videos, I'm just expressing what the Lord is leading me to say. That's it. That's not my natural way. When I'm not making a video, I'm, as you know, a lot of times at the end of my video, I'll start talking, and then that's the real me. So anyway, that's the real me. God bless you guys. Love you guys. I know the Lord is going to send all the right people that need to see me in shadow. I just ask you guys to pray about it. I can make a plan for a more of a long-term stay up there. I'm assuming I'll stay like about a month. I guess I need to get extended stay hotel or something. God bless you guys.